Amen. God bless you. Our God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
All is good.
Amen. Are you excited to be in His presence this morning?
Yes.
Amen. Are we in the book of Nehemiah?
Yes,
Nehemiah
sir.
Chapter 1. If you're there, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Nehemiah chapter 1. This morning, God has us continuing on the theme of godly leadership. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I thought for a moment this week that it was time to move on. Amen. And the Holy Spirit, I believe, said no. Amen.
Amen.
And when He said no, I saw confirmation. Amen.
Amen.
Within a few minutes. Amen.
Amen.
And I said, okay, Lord, whatever You want us to do, we will do. Amen.
Amen.
And so this morning, we're going to continue as we look at a topic or the idea, the topic titled Nehemiah, a model of biblical leadership. Amen?
Amen.
Nehemiah, a model of biblical leadership. And so I read this morning from verse 1. Please follow along in your Bibles. Early the following spring, in the month of Nisan, during the 20th year of King Artaxerxes' reign, I was serving the king his wine. Excuse me, I'm in Nehemiah chapter 2 instead of Nehemiah chapter 1. These are the memoirs of Nehemiah, son of Hakaliah. In late autumn, in the month of Kislev, in the 20th year of King Artaxerxes' reign, I was at the fortress of Susa. Hanani, one of my brothers, came to visit me with some other men who had just arrived from Judah. I asked them about the Jews who had returned there from captivity and about how things were going in Jerusalem. They said to me, "Things are not going well for those who returned to the province of Judah. They are in great trouble and disgrace. The wall of Jerusalem has been torn down and the gates have been destroyed by fire." When I heard this, I sat down and wept. In fact, for days I mourned, fasted, and prayed to the God of heaven. Then I said, "O Lord God of heaven, the great and awesome God who keeps His covenant of unfailing love with those who love Him and obey His commands, listen to my prayer." Somebody say, prayer.
Prayer.
"Look down and see me praying night and day for Your people, Israel. I confess that we have sinned against You. Yes, even my own family and I have sinned. We have sinned terribly by not obeying the commands, decrees, and regulations that You gave us through Your servant Moses. Please remember what You told Your servant Moses. If you are unfaithful to Me, I will scatter you among the nations. But if you return to Me and obey My commands and live by them, then even if you are exiled to the ends of the earth, I will bring you back to the place I have chosen for My name to be honored. The people You rescued by Your great power and strong hand are Your servants. O Lord," verse 11, "O Lord, please hear my prayer. Listen to the prayers of those of us who delight in honoring You. Please grant me success today by making the king favorable to me. Put it into his heart to be kind to me." And Nehemiah ends with these words, "In those days, I was the king's cupbearer." May the Lord bless the reading of His word this morning in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Like I said earlier, so far we've looked at leadership. We've looked at the story of the call of Moses, and we've seen several principles, amen?
Amen?
Lessons about the call to leadership. And if we were to try to summarize, talking this morning about models of biblical leadership, amen?
Amen.
Amen? Amen. From the lives of these great men and women, leaders in the Bible, we can learn principles, amen?
Amen.
We can see a pattern, principles woven in their stories, threads that we can glean from and then we can learn from. And I suppose that if we were to summarize the leadership model of Moses, a good summary could be Moses, a man who was humble and patient, a patient leader of a people with little faith. Amen.
Amen.
But Moses, one of the overriding things we see in his life, humility, patience. Now we know that his patience wore thin, but he was a meek man. Amen.
Amen.
In the book of Numbers, chapter 12, verse 3, it says, "Now the man Moses was very meek above all the men who were upon the face of the earth." Amen.
Amen.
Moses, if we were to summarize, a good summary could be he was a humble and a patient leader of a people with little faith. Last week we saw the story of Paul. Amen. And Paul's encounter with the Ephesian leaders of the Ephesian church, elders, we read in the book of Acts. And if we were to summarize Paul's model of leadership, a good summary could be a leader who believed in something bigger than himself. Amen.
Amen.
He thought of himself as what? Nothing. He believed in something what? Bigger than himself. No wonder he could say in Philippians 1, verse 21, "For to me to live is Christ." Amen.
Amen.
"And to die is what?
Gain."
Amen. He says, goes on and says in other places, "I've counted all things but lost." He believed in something bigger than himself. Amen.
Amen.
Nehemiah. A good summary of his leadership model could be a man of prayer who built on what God had given him.
Amen.
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 A man of prayer who built on what God had given him. When we first encounter Nehemiah in chapter 1, we have read this morning, he is the cupbearer to King Artaxerxes. Amen.
Amen.
And I think that Nehemiah might be able to relate with us today, living in the Pacific Northwest, amen?
Amen.
With our comfortable lives, amen? In his role as the king's cupbearer, Nehemiah could have been expected to be comfortable. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I won't go there this morning. Amen. He could have been expected to be comfortable. Amen.
Amen.
But Nehemiah was not satisfied with what God had given to him. Amen.
Amen.
He had a desire to do more. He wanted to build on what God had given to him. And so he stepped up to a challenge that no one had accepted for decades. It was a challenge to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. Amen.
Amen.
He wanted more. Now make no mistake, the challenge wasn't just about rebuilding the walls. Amen.
Amen.
Somebody say the challenge was more than rebuilding the walls. The vision was to rebuild the walls, but the walls were not the most important part of the vision. Amen.
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 Amen. The vision was rebuild the walls. When we look through Nehemiah's story, if I asked you the first thing, what comes to mind when you think about Nehemiah? Most of us would say, oh, he was the man who rebuilt the walls. Amen.
Amen.
But the walls were not the most important part of the vision. Amen.
Amen.
The walls were a means to a larger purpose. And through Nehemiah's story, we see Nehemiah discovered there was more to his purpose than rebuilding the wall. Amen.
Amen.
The purpose of God was to help the Jewish people, help the Israel nation, help the nation of Judah reclaim their identity as a people of faith.
Amen.
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 Reclaim their identity as a people of faith. And so Nehemiah was faithful. He kept bringing the people back to the vision. Amen.
Amen.
But he never forgot what the real purpose was about. Amen.
Amen.
And so it wasn't just the walls we see in the story of Nehemiah. Nehemiah addressed issues of inequality and exploitation. Amen.
Amen.
Nehemiah faced issues dealing with food shortages in a time of famine. Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
Nehemiah had to address the wealthy in the society and give them instructions, godly instructions. Amen.
Amen.
Nehemiah took a registration of all the people of Israel after the wall was completed. God put it in his mind, take a registration of the people of Israel. In the final chapter 12 and 13, we see Nehemiah bringing the people back to the vision.
Yes.
They had forsaken some aspects of the temple and God's instructions, and Nehemiah, he understood that his purpose was more than a wall. Amen.
Amen.
Church, our purpose is more than any project.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God has put us here in the Pacific Northwest for a grand plan, a grand purpose. And like my brother said earlier today, we must seek his face in all things.
Amen.
So that we will be able to achieve what he has called us to. Amen.
Amen.
I need to move. I need to move. And so real quick, we will look at four lessons. Four lessons from the life of Nehemiah on godly leadership. Amen.
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 How did this man move? How did he, what did he do? What can we learn from his life? A man of prayer who built on what God had given unto him. And the first thing I want to draw our attention to, that I believe God is drawing our attention to, perhaps the most important thing in this message today, is that a godly leader must have prayer as a foundational principle.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Prayer as a foundation. I am so grateful to God, Brother Bolade. What you shared was a confirmation of what God had been putting in my heart. Something God had been putting in my heart. And I will phrase it this way. There is nothing too small to pray about.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. That's in my notes, sir. And when you said, do you pray about what clothes to wear? Amen. How many of you know that that might seem trivial? It might seem trivial, but it's not. Nehemiah was a man whom we see constantly. At the core of his life, we see prayer is a constant thing. In the book of Nehemiah chapter 1, verse 3 and 4, they said to me, things are not going well. When I heard this, verse 4, I sat down and wept. In fact, for days I mourned, fasted, and what? Prayed. Amen. I mourned, fasted, and prayed. In the story, we see emphasis. He says, I prayed day and night. Amen. By the time we get to chapter 2, which I had mistakenly started to read earlier, and Nehemiah is going before King Artaxerxes, 4 months have passed from when Nehemiah receives this initial message about Jerusalem. About 4 months have passed. If you read the Bible there, it says in the fall. By the time you get to chapter 2, it says in the spring, early in the spring. 4 months have passed. He was a man who made prayer a priority. No wonder by the time he got to the king, he received favor. Amen.
Amen.
Nehemiah chapter 2, verse 4 and 5. The king asked him, well, how can I help you? The next phrase in my Bible says, with the prayer to the God of heaven. I replied. Amen.
Amen.
A man who made prayer a priority. Amen.
Amen.
He made prayer a priority. He made prayer a focus. Too often as leaders, we jump into a project or a task without seeking God's direction or intervention first. I think one thing we learn from the life of Nehemiah, Lord, what would you have me do? There's nothing too small to pray about. That's what I have in my notes. And similarly, there's nothing too big to pray about. Amen.
Amen.
In fact, in the book of Philippians, we see the instructions, don't be anxious about anything. Instead, what? Pray about everything. Amen.
Amen.
By the time we get to Nehemiah chapter 4, verse 4 to 5, then I prayed again. Hear us, O God. Opposition has arisen by this point. And Nehemiah again defaults. He immediately defaults to what? Prayer. I pray, may God give us understanding.
Amen. Amen.
May God give us wisdom. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Because it is only in the place of prayer that we receive the vision from God.
Amen.
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 It is only in the place of depending on Him that we can receive the vision. And if I would be a godly leader, if you would be a godly leader, we must understand the true vision is God inspired.
Amen.
It is God revealed. And it is God sustained. And prayer is one means by which God sustains the vision for His work. Amen. The vision must be, as Nehemiah says in the book of Nehemiah, chapter 2, verse 12, the vision must be what God has put in my heart. Amen.
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 The vision is only what God has put in our hearts. Amen.
Amen.
It's God inspired, it's God revealed, and it's God sustained. Amen.
Amen.
Nehemiah shows us that strong leadership results when prayer is at the center of our plans. Godly leadership, pleasing to God, strong, effective, has a foundation of prayer. Amen.
Amen.
Number two, a godly leader plans effectively. Amen.
Amen.
Now, one extreme is that we proceed and we rush with our plans and our ideas without consulting God. But it could also be an extreme that we neglect to plan. Amen.
Amen.
A godly leader doesn't ignore planning, expecting God will make it all come together. Amen. A godly leader understands that we partner with God. We partner with the Holy Spirit. And so we must trust God. We must use the resources He has given unto us. And we must plan effectively. Amen.
Amen.
In Nehemiah chapter 2, verse 6 to 9, after the king has asked Nehemiah, well, how can I help you? Nehemiah has prayed. In verse 6, we see the king with the queen, so it's sitting beside him, asked, how long will you be gone? When will you return? If Nehemiah was not an effective planner, Nehemiah at that point might say, oh, king, you know what? Give me a day. I'll get back to you, sir. No, what do we see Nehemiah? After I told him, Nehemiah is able to give the king an answer immediately. Why? Because he is an effective planner. Not only does he stop there, because he has planned effectively, Nehemiah is able to tell the king, please address a letter to the governors of the provinces. He came prepared. Let me ask you this. Did Nehemiah know that on that day the king would ask him, why are you sad?
No.
But we see a man who was what? Prepared. We see a man who had planned. And so he knew, king, I need a letter. I need a letter to the governors of the provinces through which I would travel. Not only does he ask for that, he asks for a letter to Asaph, the manager of the king's forest. He knows his name. I'm not sure. Maybe he knew it before. He knows what he wants. I know how long I'm going to be gone. I know when I'm going to return. Here's what I need. I need timber. I need letters. And because he came prepared, God added to what he asked for. We don't see a record of him asking for an army or army officers or horsemen. Amen.
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 But in verse 9, I believe, it says, the king, I should add, had sent along army officers and horsemen to protect me.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We must pray, but we must also have effective plans and rely on the Holy Spirit. Amen. To guide those plans. Amen.
Amen.
And be prepared. We see again Nehemiah effective planning. By the time he gets to Jerusalem, in Nehemiah chapter 3, I don't think I've ever read these, or it was a bit new to me as I was reading it in preparation for this message. See the division of labor, incredible division of labor that Nehemiah goes through in chapter 3.
Yes.
And he begins to tell the families and the people, and he begins to narrate, this family built the wall from this to this. And this family built the wall from this point to this point, from the temple, and this man built the wall directly in front of his house, and this man and his family built the wall from this point to this point. How many of you know that takes incredible planning?
Amen.
Amen. We don't just see the people kind of running around haphazardly. Amen.
Amen.
We don't see people showing up and saying, oh wait, I thought I was doing this wall and you were doing this wall. And no, okay, maybe I shouldn't show up and I didn't know I should be at this wall today. No. He plans what? Come on, help me this morning.
Effectively.
He plans effectively. He divided the labor into segments. He was able to communicate to the groups of Israelites that the wall would be built faster if teams focused on making their sections the best. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And we see that the wall was built through effective planning, through a division of labor. Godly leadership requires effective planning. Amen.
Amen.
Point number 3, a godly leader learns to deal with opposition. Amen.
Amen.
I forgot to mention earlier, we had already seen some points last week, and we should repeat them this week. From the life of Paul, we saw 4 qualities about godly leadership. Transparent integrity, amen.
Amen.
A servant attitude, amen.
Yes.
Humility, amen.
Amen.
And a faithfulness to biblical teaching.
Amen.
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 Somebody say transparent integrity.
Transparent integrity.
Somebody say a servant attitude.
A servant attitude.
Someone say humility.
Humility.
Somebody say faithfulness to teaching the Bible.
Faithfulness to teaching the Bible.
So we're building on that this morning. We've already seen another principle, prayer. Amen.
Amen.
We've seen another principle, effective planning. Amen.
Amen.
And now we see that a leader, a godly leader, learns to deal with opposition. In Nehemiah chapter 4, verse 1 to 15, we read the accounts of the opposition to the building of the wall.
Yes.
Let's read from verse 6 together this morning, if we can project that. A godly leader learns to deal with opposition. At last, the wall was completed to half its height around the entire city. For the people had worked with enthusiasm. Amen.
Amen.
Somebody say enthusiasm.
Enthusiasm.
Verse 7, let's continue. But when Sanballat and Tobiah and the Arabs, Ammonites and Ashdodites heard that the work was going ahead and that the gaps in the wall of Jerusalem were being repaired, they were furious. They all made plans to come and fight against Jerusalem and throw us into confusion. But we prayed to our God and guarded the city day and night to protect ourselves. Let's continue. Verse 8. Then the people of Judah began to complain. The workers are getting tired and there's so much rubble to be moved. We will never be able to build the wall by ourselves. An enthusiastic group of women
yes.
had become discouraged. Verse 10, can we go back? Had become discouraged. And began to complain, and began to get tired, and began to doubt whether they could finish the work because of opposition.
Yes.
They were enthusiastic. The wall had been built to half its height. But then opposition comes, and Nehemiah must deal with the opposition if the work is going to complete. Amen. Verse 11, let's continue. Meanwhile, our enemies were saying, before they know what's happening, we will swoop down on them and kill them and end their work. The Jews who lived there, the enemy came and told us again and again, they will come from all directions and attack us. So I placed, look at this, verse 13, so I placed armed guards behind the lowest parts of the wall in the exposed areas. I stationed the people to stand guard by families, armed with swords, spears, and bows. Verse 14. Then as I looked over the situation, I called together the nobles and the rest of the people and said to them, don't be afraid of the enemy. Remember the Lord who is great and glorious, and fight for your brothers, your sons, your daughters, your wives, and your homes. When our enemies heard that we knew of their plans and that God had frustrated them, look at this, we all returned to our work on the wall.
Amen.
Amen. A godly leader dealt effectively with opposition. The wall that could have stayed half built was completed. Amen. Amen. How did he do it? How did he deal with opposition? Two sub points here. The first is that he was courageous.
Yes.
Amen. We touched on this last week. He didn't shrink back in a time of difficulty. Instead, he placed armed guards. Again, back to planning. Amen.
Amen.
Courage. He dealt with opposition via courage. The second point I want to raise in Nehemiah chapter 6. Opposition again arises. Verse 1 to 13, you can note it down and read it later. But we see that the opposition was sustained. The opposition that had subsided after this initial incident was sustained. If you read verse 4, you'll see there the opposition was sustained. It said four times they sent him a message to try to discourage him. They tried to distract him and harm him, saying, hey, come, let's meet. Four times. But Nehemiah ignored them. Then they tried to intimidate him by spreading rumors that he wanted to be the king. They said, oh, we know. You just want to be king. And word will get back to the king. Try to intimidate him. And finally, they tried to deceive him. And the second point, we should read it this morning. Nehemiah chapter 6. Let's read that story to get the context. Nehemiah chapter 6. Verse 10, later, so after they had tried to tell him, hey, come, so we can meet. And he saw through their plans, and then they said, oh, you're just trying to be king. They're spreading rumors. Now, we read, later I went to Shemaiah, son of Deliah, and grandson of Mehetabel, who was confined to his home. He said, let us meet together inside the temple of God. Listen to this, and bolt the doors shut. Your enemies are coming to kill you tonight. Now they're trying to deceive him. But I replied, should someone in my position run from danger? I love the King James Version. Should a man such as I, amen.
Amen.
Should someone in my position enter the temple to save his life? No, I won't do it. And listen to these next words, verse 12. I realized that God had not spoken to him, but that he had uttered this prophecy against me because Tobiah and Sanballat had hired him. They were hoping to intimidate me and make me sin. Then they would be able to accuse and discredit me. When they tried to intimidate him and they failed, when they tried to spread rumors and they failed, they tried to make him afraid. But Nehemiah had a spirit of discernment.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. And a godly leader must have a spirit of discernment.
Amen.
A godly leader must be courageous. A godly leader must also be discerning. Amen.
Amen.
And he says, should a man such as I run from danger? May God help us in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
Godly leader needs to be courageous and discerning in the face of opposition. And finally this morning, a godly leader will defend the weak and the poor. Amen.
Amen.
A godly leader will defend the weak and the poor. We read in Nehemiah chapter 5, an internal threat. We talked about the opposition that came from Sanballat and Tobiah. Those were external threats. But Nehemiah kept his eyes fixed on the purpose. It wasn't just a wall, remember? It was helping the Jewish people rediscover their identity of faith. Helping the nation of Judah discover their identity of faith. And so in Nehemiah chapter 5,
We read these words. About this time, some of the men and their wives raised a cry of protest against their fellow Jews. They were saying, "We have such large families, we need more food to survive." Others said, "We have mortgaged our fields, vineyards, and homes to get food during the famine." And others said, "We have had to borrow money on our fields and vineyards to pay our taxes. We belong to the same family as those who are wealthy, and our children are just like theirs. Yet we must sell our children into slavery just to get enough money to live." And of course, the implication there is that the wealthy did not have to do that. "We've already sold some of our daughters and we are helpless to do anything about it, for our fields and vineyards are already mortgaged." They cried out because of a shortage of food, verse 2. They cried out because they had to mortgage the property to buy food, verse 3. They cried out because they were under a heavy burden of taxes, verse 4. And they cried out, verse 5, because some of them even had to sell their children into slavery just to get by. They felt totally helpless. We saw that in verse 5. Totally helpless. We've done everything. We've already mortgaged our fields. We've sold some of our daughters. Helpless. And how did Nehemiah respond to their concerns? In verse 6, "When I heard their complaints, I was very angry. After thinking it over, I spoke out against these nobles and officials. I told them, 'You're hurting your own relatives by charging interest when they borrow money.' Then I called a public meeting to deal with the problem. At the meeting, I said to them, 'We're doing all we can to redeem our Jewish relatives who have had to sell themselves to pagan foreigners, but you are selling them back into slavery again. How often must we redeem them?' And they had nothing to say in their defense. Then I pressed further, 'What you are doing is not right. Should you not walk in the fear of our God in order to avoid being mocked by enemy nations? I myself, as well as my brothers and my workers, have been lending the people money and grain, but now let us stop this business of charging interest. You must restore their fields, vineyards, olive groves, and homes to them when? This very day." Amen. "And repay the interest you charged when you lent them money, grain, new wine, and olive oil." They replied, "We will give back everything and demand nothing more from the people. We will do as you say." Look at Nehemiah. "Then I called the priests and made the nobles and officials swear to do what they had promised." He wasn't letting them off lightly. "I shook out the folds of my robe and said, 'If you fail to keep your promise, may God shake you like this from your homes and from your property.' The whole assembly responded, 'Amen.' And they praised the Lord. And the people did as they had promised. For the entire 12 years that I was governor of Judah, from the 20th year to the 32nd year of the reign of King Artaxerxes, neither I nor my officials drew on our official food allowance." He led by example. The former governors, in contrast, had laid heavy burdens on the people, demanding a daily ration of food and wine besides 40 pieces of silver. Even their assistants took advantage of the people, but because I feared God, I did not act this way. Nehemiah didn't just speak out on behalf of the weak and the poor. He defended them. Amen.
Amen.
He made the people swear. And he shook out his robe and said, "If you don't obey, God will shake you out." Stern words, amen.
Amen.
And he led by example. He said he didn't take his allowance. Not to even talk about the practices of the previous governors who would demand things from the people. A godly leader defends the weak and the poor. Amen.
Amen.
A godly leader. Nehemiah models for us biblical leadership. We learn lessons. A man of prayer who, by God's grace, was able to build on what God had given him. He was a comfortable man. He could have just chilled in Babylon, lived out his days.
But he said, no, I'm going to build on what God has given me. God has given me influence. I'm going to build on it. Amen.
Amen.
God has given me a position. I'm going to build on it. Amen.
Amen.
God has given me wealth. I'm going to build on it. Amen.
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 God has given me relationship capital. I'm going to build on it. Amen.
Amen.
How many of you know access to the King is capital?
Amen.
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 He refused to be satisfied with what God had given him. But he used that influence to defend the weak and the poor. You know, this week, by God's grace, we will be celebrating Thanksgiving. A time to celebrate, a time to rejoice, a time to be around family, church family. But can I ask us as a church community, let me rephrase that. Is God asking us as a church family in this season of Thanksgiving and by God's grace, Christmas, amen.
Amen.
The holidays are upon us, Thanksgiving, and then a few weeks later, Christmas. But is God asking us as a church family not just to celebrate His goodness, amen,
amen.
But to defend the weak and the poor, amen. How may God be calling us to serve the weak and the poor in our community? We see from the life of Nehemiah, it wasn't about the project. Amen. There was a bigger purpose behind it all. And I pray that God would help us not to miss His purpose.
Amen. Amen.
But that we would fulfill all that He has called us to as a church, in our families, and as individuals. In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Amen. Would you rise to your feet this afternoon? As we close today, I'd like to invite you to speak with the Lord. Speak with the Lord. Respond to Him today. Respond to Him today. Lord, in my sphere of influence, please help me to be a godly leader. God knows why He has kept us on leadership for so long. Lord, help me to be a godly leader. We've already established leadership is not a title. Each one of us is a leader. Lord, help me to be a godly leader. Help me to be a godly leader. Help me to be a leader who walks with transparent integrity. Help me to be a leader who has a servant attitude. Help me to be a leader, oh God, who is humble, like we see in the story of Moses. Help me to be a leader who faithfully teaches the word. Help me to be a man or woman that is completely dependent on You in prayer. Help me to be a leader who plans effectively, delegates, plans. Help me to be a leader who deals with opposition courageously and with discernment. Father, help me to be a leader who defends the weak and the poor. Please show us how to minister to the needs of those in our community over the next several weeks and beyond. As a church family, God, help us, Lord, not to tune out our ears to the needy around us, but help us to truly engage with whatever purpose You have for us. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. Would you make that your prayer? 60 more seconds. Father, I want to be a godly leader. Father, I desire to be a godly leader. I desire to be a godly leader. There's so much we can talk about leadership. Examples of men and women throughout scripture. Lord, help me to be counted among those who are godly leaders. Lord, help me not to go astray. Help me not to miss the way. In my home, in every position of influence, help me, oh God, to reflect and to model godly leadership. Please help me, oh God. Please help us, oh God. Please help us, oh God. Please help us, oh God.
I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back.
Shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever.